Welcome to the Mental Insights Podcast. This is your host, Brennan Catulli, and we're here today for episode number 11. And we have a special guest today, my good friend, Matthew Wray. And we actually grew up together a lot through our childhood, and we have a lot to speak about in terms of drugs and alcohol within addiction and within living a healthy lifestyle and focusing on being mentally and physically healthy throughout our own life. And we're going to share some stories about what we used to go through when we were children, when we were young adults throughout our past. And we're going to have a lot to share throughout, you know, what we faced and, you know, how we were able to overcome our obstacles in our life and what Matt is doing now and how he's playing a crucial role into his own development and others around him through facing sobriety. So Matt, if you want to give a introduction about, you know, a little bit more about who you are and what you're currently doing now, that'd be great.
Cool, man. Yeah. Hey guys, I'm Matt Wray. I'm currently a student at College of Charleston studying business admin. For work, I'm a contractor, I'm a roofer, I'm a senior project manager for a roofing company in Charleston, South Carolina. Moved down here in 2015, and it's been great ever since. So that's really what I'm doing now.
Awesome. Thank you, Matt. And, you know, we'll kick right off this interview just first. I mean, we met probably around when we were, you know, 13, 14 years old. I believe we met through your brother, Griffin, and we were in, I believe, around eighth grade in freshman year is really when our friendship truly kicked off. Yeah. But you know, to start off, you know, we were both introduced to drugs and alcohol at a young age. For me, around 12 years old is when I was really starting to, you know, be shown it and, you know, be pressured into, you know, trying to see if this was something that, you know, we would be doing with friends and, you know, testing, you know, and implementing a lot of these different drugs and alcohol into our own life. So why don't you speak about when you were first, you know, aware of drugs and alcohol and, you know, when you started to, you know about it and start to experiment with, you know, with these different types of substances.
Yeah, man. So, you know, I always had the curiosity of, you know, what are drugs? Why do people do them? And you know, growing up, our parents always told us, you know, drugs are bad, don't do drugs. But I always had the question of like, if they're so bad, then why do so many people do them? Why are they issues? And I was really curious about what they were. And I did a lot of research on the computer, you know, went into incognito mode a few times and just try to do my research on what, you know, what these drugs were and why they were so bad. And, you know, eventually I was presented with a few opportunities to partake. The first of which I think I was 12 years old, and it was right around Christmas time. And someone who I was very close to, who I looked up to, came to me and said, "Hey, you know, I got something and I think you might like it." And this is someone who I was very close with. And, you know, we bonded over many different things. And I think he probably wanted to, you know, maybe find another parallel within drugs and alcohol with me. But anyways, he came to me and he offered me drugs. He gave me oxycodone. And this is before I hadn't smoked weed. I hadn't taken, you know, anything else really. And I tried it. And I remember taking it thinking like, oh my God, like, what am I doing? This is terrible. And I took it and like an hour later it hit me and I felt amazing. I was like, this is it. You know, this is the most amazing thing that I've ever felt before. And it's like, I understood. I was like, I understand why people do drugs. I understand all this. But what I didn't understand was the issue. I didn't understand the problem, because I was like, this feels so good. People should do this all the time. People would be happier. The world would be a better place. And it really just went from there. And I started looking at drugs as a really positive thing, because someone in my life who was very close to and I looked up to introduced them to me. So I continued doing them and seeking them out. Started smoking a lot of pot. Of course, alcohol, one and the same with all the rest. You know, it's a drug. I was drinking a lot, just doing whatever I could to get that euphoria and feel good. And it really just took off from there. So that was really my introduction into substances.
Definitely. Thank you for sharing that. And I think you touched on a lot of different themes that we can dive into. And I think the one being most important is the people around you that lead you to using substances and to trying these different, substances throughout your life. And for me, it was the same thing. You know, I had friends, I had people that were close to me that would reach out and say, you know, oh, why don't you try this? You know, it was, you know, first, why don't we try to smoke pot together? You know, why don't we drink some alcohol on the weekend? Why don't we hang out and do this? And, you know, it constantly spirals down. But why don't you speak about how the impact of kind of relationships and peer pressure can cause, you know, a lot of negatives and a lot of different experimentation throughout, you know, your own drug use as you progressed forward.
Yeah, so I mean, you put two people together who might be dealing with similar issues, might be, you know, wanting similar things. Because for me, it became about getting away from reality. You know, just absolutely losing, my grip on what was going on in the world. Because if I could escape and I didn't have to pay attention to my responsibilities and my emotions, then I was free, or that's what I thought. And so, when you get a couple people together who have that similar mindset, who are going through things or who really just want to have fun, and they start doing these things together, they begin to become catalysts for each other, and they begin to go out and help each other seek these things out. From there, it really just builds. And I have several friends who, I started using with, and our addictions our use got a lot more intense and a lot more dangerous when we were together, because, you know, we both were, is two combined forces trying to do one very destructive thing. When those things build off each other, it's unpredictable, and you don't know what's going to happen. So yeah, I think it's very important to just kind of be aware of who you're surrounding yourself with, what those people are doing, what their intentions are, what their motives are and their goals. Because that was ultimately my downfall, was meeting new people that introduced me to newer things, more dangerous things, more addictive things, and just taking the torch and running with it, so.
Yeah, it definitely seems like you have friends around you that are trying to, do good things, and you're still able to, hang out and relax. But then once you start gaining that pressure and you start saying, oh, I like this high, I like this ecstasy, you're reaching a new euphoria within your own life, that then it becomes just, how can I get as high as I possibly could with this person? And then the intention changes. So if you want, I think that, you spoke about intentions a minute ago, and I think that's an important kind of topic, because, when we were hanging out and when we started doing all of these, substances and alcohol, it's our intention originally, it's just, it is to get high and it's to escape from reality. But also it was kind of like, that was kind of our only known thing of, let's hang out, but, we can go to the beach, we can go downtown, we can do this, we can do that. But it's always supplemented with, let's get high, let's get drunk, let's always do something else. And I think that your intention really changes once you feel that you constantly need it. So why don't you speak about how your own intentions changed when you started using substances related to drugs and alcohol?
Yeah, so I'm not going to lie, man. For a long time, I had the time of my life. You know, you and me, we had amazing times, you know, smoking weed in places we shouldn't have. You know, several occasions we would tell our parents we were doing school projects and we would go and get high. And that was super fun, you know, just being at that age. And there are a lot of kids who do that at that age. And, you know, a couple of years go by and, you know, maybe they get into a little bit of trouble, but they end up all right. And, you know, for us, you know, it was fun for a while. And there were times that I look back on and I can honestly think that was a good time. But the progression just goes from, you know, it's like one day you go to the beach, you know, we had a really good time at the beach. It was fun. The sun was out. We were swimming. Cool. The next day, you know, someone brings out some pot. We smoke pot at the beach. And then it's like super fun. You know, the sun is a little bit brighter. The water feels great. You know, the food tastes amazing. And then it's like, you know, why don't we do this again? And you do it again and again and again to the point where living life without getting high or drunk or whatever it may be is not an option, because life isn't fun anymore, because, you know, the intoxicated life has become your norm. And at that point, you're not trying to have fun anymore. You're just trying to maintain, you know, a level of happiness, not even happiness, more of a level of just being at baseline and being able to get through life. And that, you know, I think for me and possibly for you, you know, that transition happened pretty quickly. So it's really, you know, it happens very quickly. You don't even see it happen. And the next minute you're like, we need to get high. So.
Totally. I completely agree. And I think, you know, this does lead to a great conversation of, you know, the differentiation of the use of like pills and harder substances compared to weed and alcohol, because at least for me, pills was always my go-to, because it was always that quick, easy fix. And it had so much more potential in terms of reaching that, you know, that full euphoria. And I think the differentiation for me was, you know, whenever you can get pills, you can get pills and you want to take them. But then, you know, the weed and the alcohol is just that kind of that small suppressor that you can do whenever you can't find pills or you can't have that full fix. And why don't you speak about that? Because I think it's so important when, you know, when you first do take a pill, you start to realize how people become that addicted, because once you start taking them pretty frequently, you do really experience withdrawals and not really understanding why that you need this constantly and you need that fix. So why don't you speak about kind of the differentiation between, you know, the use of pills and opioids versus drugs and, or in terms of weed and alcohol compared to opioids?
Yeah. So, you know, for me, it was, even though I started with most people's stories are, you know, they start smoking pot, their friends, they start drinking, steal your dad's beer, whatever. For me, I tried, the first thing I ever did was oxycodone, was opiate. So that was my introduction to really any sort of intoxication. And of course I loved it. So that's really what I wanted to chase more than anything. And that quickly progressed to within a year, I was doing heroin every day. And you know, that was much cheaper. It was easier to get at that point. And, you know, for me, there was no reason not to do it, because my parents still, you know, were helping me out, and I was, just kind of coasting by and kind of just staying under the radar. So it works for me for a little bit. But you know, comparing that lifestyle and that high and that experience to smoking weed all the time and drinking, I do think they're two different things. And I think that, first of all, I think that really anything used in excess is a bad thing. And you can, you know, someone can have the same bottom from smoking weed all the time that they can have from, you know, shooting heroin, because it's all up here. But, you know, at the same time, I would absolutely draw some parallels, because, you know, you look at things like weed and alcohol, and people look at them and they're accepted in society, right? Weed is sold legally in a lot of places. Alcohol is sold legally everywhere, pretty much. And, you know, they're looked at as these normal things. You see your parents doing them. You see your cousin doing it. You see your brother, you know, whatever. Everyone's doing it. It's okay. You know, we can do it too. And like I mentioned earlier, for a lot of kids and people, it is okay, you know, and people are able to handle that. And, you know, for me, if I take a hit off of a joint versus, you know, if I take a bump of heroin or, you know, whatever, those are going to be two completely different experiences. With heroin, the dopamine receptors are just, you know, going crazy. You feel amazing. Weed is a little bit, you know, more kind of relaxed and not as intense. And that's probably why people have less of a tendency to, you know, go full blown addiction and burn their lives down because of it. So I would absolutely draw parallels. But I would not say that, you know, weed and alcohol have any less of an ability to cripple someone in the sense of addiction, you know? And with that being said, I think that marijuana especially is an extremely helpful thing. And I absolutely support the medical use of it, the legalization of it. I think it'd be a great thing. You know, I've seen it do more good than bad. So.
Definitely. Yeah. It seems like we're entering, you know, a new period and a new phase of how drugs are being used. And I think, you know, like what we were talking about, it's all about intention. And obviously for someone who, if you do take a substance and you constantly feel like you need to have it and you like to use it in excess, then whatever substance it is, whether it's, you know, cocaine, weed, or alcohol, you're going to abuse it and you shouldn't be using substances. But for some people, it obviously is, it can be a very helpful thing. You know, weed's coming to a very big, you know, it's legal in what, probably like 3 or 4 states now. And even psilocybin is becoming decriminalized. So that's becoming into a new forum through a lot of different psychotherapies for people. And, you know, it's good to see that there are some good uses in terms of drugs that people are able to use. But I liked how you were talking about intentions and tendencies within people. And for me, when I was, you know, using pills and smoking and drinking all the time, I really would show out in terms of trying to either steal from people or hurt some of my friends. I was always selfish in terms of, you know, I just wanted to get high and I didn't really care about a lot of the friends around me. So, you know, what kind of tendencies did you see as whether you were using or people around you? For anybody who's listening and, you know, they have people around them that they necessarily don't know are using, or maybe they have a slight insight, what could be some tendencies that someone would pick up for someone that is using any type of substance or abusing it in any way?
Yeah. So the first thing for me that comes to mind in my experience is, you know, I started isolating a very unhealthy amount and really just going home, going to my room, sitting there and just coming up with ways to, you know, get high or get drunk or get what I wanted, really. Because, you know, we're talking about intentions. And, you know, for me, I started isolating, maybe hung out with 2 or 3 people, and we're all trying to get high. And started stealing a lot, you know, stealing from my mom, my dad, my siblings, my little sister, you know, just really anyone, any family member, anyone. It really did not matter who it was, because I kind of looked at it as, they're not going to find out it was me. And if they do, hey, I'll pay you back sometime, you know. And it was always just pushing it back. I'll take care of this later. I'll handle this later. And I had a lot of people who were very angry with me, and who were very sad at you know, what I was doing, because, you know, what sucks about, you know, someone who is struggling with addiction is you can do everything you want to try to help this person. You can send them to rehab. My parents sent me to rehab 5 times. You know, I've been in outpatient programs. They made me go to AA meetings for a long time, you know, when I was 16, 17 years old. And that did absolutely nothing for me because I didn't want it at all. And, you know, so it sucks because you're watching someone burn their life down and they're burning your life down. And you're really just a sinking ship with no support. So, yeah, I would definitely say just kind of look for someone's maybe isolating, if you're missing valuables, money, things like that. And you know, really just my general attitude. I was an absolute asshole to everyone in my family, my friends. You know, you and me lost contact for a long time. And a lot of my other close friends, I just kind of cut off and didn't worry about what was going on with them because all I was worried about was myself. So really just any sort of selfish tendencies. You know, I want this, I want it now, whether that's within an attitude, a tone of voice, or action. You know, I think those are very good indicators that someone is, you know, maybe starting to go down the wrong path.
Perfect. Thank you for sharing that, Matt. And you touched on a very important theme that I think, you know, resonates with any type of addiction or illness that someone could be facing. Is whatever someone's doing around you, basically friends and family can reach out and help you, and they could try to bring you to a new light and try to offer guidance, support, but it's the person themselves that's facing this addiction, this illness, that wants to seek that help. And why don't you speak about what was that mindset change? What was that fix that made you say, all right, I need the help. I want to go get that help, because that is a huge step. That's, if not one of the biggest steps in your first road to recovery.
Yeah. So, you know, I had to burn a lot of bridges. I had to fall many times. And you know, it sucks to even say, but there are many people who are going to continue to burn bridges and fall down until they die. A lot of people are going to continue to die from this thing. I've lost many friends, and you know, it's a really sad thing to see. But you know, for me, I was extremely lucky in where I hit a bottom for me hard enough to where I was willing to do something different, or at least try. And I didn't have to be willing to do all the 12 steps and get a sponsor and, you know, talk to people about my feelings and do all that kind of stuff. I just had to be willing to give it a shot. So I was put in a position where, you know, my family, we lived up in Connecticut, and they were like, hey, we're moving to South Carolina. You know, we're moving 900 miles away, and you can either continue living how you're living. You can stay here. We're not going to help you. We're not going to give you any money. So you'll be homeless. You don't have any friends at this point. You know, you really don't have anything, and it's going to be cold pretty soon. And that's kind of the ultimatum that I was left with, was do I want to stay up in, you know, Connecticut with virtually nothing, or do I want to give it a try? Not even do I want to do this thing. Do I want to give it a try? Just see where it takes me. And at that point, you know, I was so beat up, you know, 4 or 5 rehabs through, that, you know, I was willing to do something else because I was ready to die. You know, I wanted to die. I didn't care if I died at that point. And so I said, you know, let's do it. And I drove with them to South Carolina. I was detoxing in the car. It was terrible. You know, my parents were pissed at me, and, you know, I was a wreck. And took 2 days to get down there. It was a miserable 2 days, and I finally got down to the rehab that I went to. It was a 12-step based rehab, and it's kind of interesting because it was like I showed up there and there was like 100 people outside that greeted me at the door, and I was like, this is weird. I don't want to be here. was trying to talk my dad out of it, you know, like, hey, take me to the house. I'll help you guys move in. You know, I'll be helpful, whatever. Just don't leave me here. And, of course, my dad was like, absolutely not. Go inside. So I went inside, and people started talking, and I started hearing their stories, and I saw a lot of – everyone was so happy, and I was like, this doesn't make sense to me. These people obviously haven't been where I'm at. And, you know, I just kind of isolated myself in the sense that there's no way that I can be this happy. And I kind of, you know, made that hard for myself to be happy. But after a little while, I started listening to what these people were saying and their experiences and what they did. And, you know, something just clicked in me. And all of a sudden, I was afraid to get high. You know, I started kind of grasping onto this little bit of light, and this little bit of hope that, okay, maybe my life will get a little bit better. My parents were kind of talking to me a little bit different. I was being a little bit more respectful. You know, I started kind of being considerate of other people and my actions, doing things slowly, little by little, that kind of showed me that I was changing as a person. And at that point, you know, I really started seeing this miracle happening in my life where I didn't want to get high. I wanted to help other people not get high anymore, not get drunk. And, you know, that was absolutely priceless to me. And I didn't want to trade that for anything. And, you know, I'm really happy that mind state has only grown with me. And I've kind of been able to practice that to the best of my ability every day.
That's great, Matt. And I think it's important that even if you don't go through the 12 steps, I've actually spoken with a lot of people that have not completely gone through all 12 steps, but it's provided such a deep impact within the way that they carry out their lives afterwards. And it's provided such a profound effect to how they just want to live their life, how they want to share their story. So why don't you speak about the impact that AA and rehab kind of did to, whether it was teach you a lesson or if it kind of motivated you to, you know, just create better relationships and create better change within your life.
Yeah, absolutely. So, you know, the 12 steps for me, I'd always heard of them, but I obviously never took part in them. I didn't care to, you know, I just wanted to feel different. And I didn't think that the steps would help me do that. But when I was finally put in a position to see what they were all about, I was pretty intrigued, because what's cool about the 12 steps and, you know, AA is, you know, the steps are literally put in order 1 through 12 for you to follow them. So it's actually a very simple process. It's not easy, but it's very simple. And they're literally written in a book for you. So if someone really wants to do it, they can open the book, they can read the steps, and they can read how to do them. And it walks you through everything. But, you know, for me, as someone who was, I mean, and still to this day, I'm extremely unorganized. I'm all over the place and I'm sporadic in whatever I do. You know, that kind of structure of the steps was very, very important for me. So I could follow something, you know, a line item, sheet, if you will, to just, you know, make my life better. And you know, so the first step for me, like the first step is admitted we're powerless. And of AA, it says admitted we're powerless over alcohol, but the 12 steps can apply to absolutely anything. You know, can apply to, you know, an eating disorder or mental health, you know, whatever you want to be applied to, it can absolutely help you, you know, change your life to where you can live either without that thing or in harmony with it. And so for me, you know, admitting I was powerless was actually pretty easy, because it was all right in front of me. You know, my life had pretty much burned down. I felt like everyone hated me. I didn't have anything. And so, all right, you know, I was like, I give up. I'm defeated. This is over. And from there, you know, it's like I took that first step, and then as the steps go on, you get into stuff. You know, the word God is mentioned a lot. A lot of people have an issue with the word God. I personally don't. but I have the utmost respect for anyone who does. But, you know, this whole idea of God really is something bigger than yourself, right? A power bigger than yourself. It can be the universe. It can be the weather. I mean, it can be whatever you make it. And, you know, I was told to look to this power, to pray to it, and, you know, just to put my trust in it, that things were going to work out. And I started doing that. And at first when I was praying, you know, I didn't know what I was doing, what I was saying. I wasn't really praying to anything, but I was just saying words at that point. And, you know, it started turning into this idea that I now have of my higher power, something that, you know, I pray to every day, something that guides me through the day. And something that I can put, you know, my faith into, in my trust, because, you know, life is a lot easier when you have something to give into and to trust, and just to let take you to where it wants you to be, you know? So, you know, the steps for me and really, I feel like for anyone in early recovery who needs that structure, who needs that guide, are extremely helpful, are extremely important. And you know, they absolutely changed my life.
That's awesome. It seems so fundamental that, you know, structure in and of itself can provide such an impact on whatever you're struggling with, you know, whether it's an addiction, an eating disorder, a mental illness. It AA can provide a home and a resource for anybody who's struggling and needs to communicate with others and hear other stories. And it's truly remarkable how it's able to impact a lot of people. And, you know, why don't you speak about, first off, how long you've been sober now, and what are some ways that you're enjoying yourself and working through health and fitness and trying to be the best you that you can?
Yeah, so my sobriety date is officially July 4th, 2015. So in July, I will have 4 years. And, you know, my recovery over the last 4 years has been very dynamic, and it's changed a lot. And, you know, at first I was kind of drilled into me that go to meetings, you know, talk to other people who are going through similar issues, and, you know, just kind of work with them to help them, and you'll be helped through that. And, you know, so it was very, very intensive. The first 2 years, probably, I was going to a lot of meetings, going to probably, you know, at least two or three a week, sometimes four, five, six, seven, whatever. And, you know, I met a lot of really good people. I think community is such a big part of the whole thing. Because when you have this community of people who are struggling with the same thing, you know, You have outlets to express how you feel. You have people to hold you accountable, and accountability is so important, you know, when you're coming in that very fragile state. But, you know, for me, as time has gone on, I don't go to as many meetings anymore. I still keep close contact with many alcoholics, people with, you know, addiction issues, whatever. My roommate is, you know, identifies in that category as well. A lot of my really, really close friends, who really all my close friends. And it's really been cool to see how we all kind of came in at the same time, and our recovery has changed because, you know, I begin to implement other things in my recovery. Like, you know, health and fitness, like you were saying, I try to go to the gym, you know, three times a week. Don't always do, sometimes more, sometimes less, but, you know, I try to eat a little bit better. I try to do more cardio. I try to really be outside as much as I can. And, you know, like you and me recently have sparked an interest in golf. You know, I golf all the time. And, you know, just being outside and being around, you know, nature and the greenery is really important to me. And I think for anyone, especially this time of year, just being outside and just, you know, feeling that cool summer air and, you know, just being able to be comfortable outside is really important. I think it's really healthy for people to get outside, turn off the TV, turn off the computer, turn off the phone, put the phone away. Let's go for a hike, you know, like let's go see some cool birds or whatever. And so, yeah, just being outside for me and being active is super important. You know, it keeps my endorphins flowing and really activates that part of me that, you know, is grateful for, you know, where I am today and where I live. And yeah, so, you know, I think that, you know, overall just implementing different things in your recovery as far as fitness goes, and just, you know, being active, being outside, being in nature, I think those are all very, very important aspects of recovery.
I love that, Matt. Those are definitely some great things to focus on. And I think definitely people will start to see that they have a lot in common in terms of those main themes about, you know, focusing on their own health and wellness. And you spoke about how a lot of people that you surround yourself with are going through recovery and are, you know, doing a lot of the same activities and goals that you are. So before I ask my last question, I just want to ask, what role do you really hope to play within people that are struggling with addiction or alcoholism or, you know, any type of mental health disorder? You know, what do you want to play a part of in the future to help them go through similar issues and, you know, by sharing your story or showing them the way that you were able to get through your own story and your own obstacles?
Yeah. So for me, you know, being 22 years old, I think I have a more of an appeal to the younger group of people coming in who have issues with these sort of things. And there are more and more, I mean, people are getting younger and younger who come into, you know, the rooms or go to rehab or wherever they go. And because, you know, today drugs are just more of an acceptable thing to do and they're more readily available. And so for me, I feel like I can be more of a vessel to the younger group. And I think that's very valuable because, you know, you get a guy who has been sober for 60 years and, you know, he's 85, you know, he might have a lot of experience and a lot of wisdom, but to, you know, a naive kid who's coming in, you know, who's 18, 19, 20, you know, that's probably not who they want to talk to. So, you know, I feel like I can kind of reach that crowd a little bit better and we probably have more similar experiences. And yeah, you know, it's just, I was always taught that, and I believe it to be true that, you know, my sobriety and my well-being, my happiness is contingent on being there for other people, doing things that are selfless and, you know, just really trying to help someone else. And, you know, when I get up and, you know, I'm praying or, you know, whatever, I'm just meditating, I'm just asking whatever's out there to help me be helpful to someone today. And, you know, I'm not going to act like I'm a saint and I'm out, you know, saving the world because I'm not. I have responsibilities like everyone else. And I like to kick it too and just, you know, chill out and do my own things. But, you know, it's, you know, when I have an opportunity to help someone else, to blatantly not take that opportunity, it's kind of like, you know, it's saying F you to the universe, you know, and to everything that helped me at first. So, you know, I feel like it's only fair to pay it forward, to give it back, because God knows how many people were there to help me out when I was struggling in the beginning. And, you know, when I'm able to do that to help someone else, I have a clear conscience, you know. And, you know, people always say, in my group, people will say, you know, you have low self-esteem. Guess what? Go do something esteemable. You know, go help someone. Go be there for someone. Because when you're doing the right thing, there's really nothing that, you know, you can't be down on yourself because, you know, you're doing what's right. It feels great. You know, I'm able to sleep a lot better at night when I know I have good intentions in that aspect.
That's great, Matt. So for my last question, I like to ask all of my guests is, imagine that you're writing a book about your life that you've experienced thus far. So you're going to have one chapter within this book that is going to capture the past year or two. So 2018, 2019, what you've experienced through that time. What would that chapter be called within your book about your life, and tell us a little bit about why, or maybe it's, you know, a theme that you've started to uncover or a lesson that you've learned. You know, what would that topic be, and explain a little bit why about why that would describe you in that chapter within your book.
It's a tough one, dude. Yeah, we're gonna have to edit this part out. I have to think about this for a second.
think about like a theme or something, just like a any type of you know, idea or concept that resonates with you throughout this past time.
Yeah, so for me, I think you know, the theme of the chapter would probably be just self-love and self-acceptance, because over the last couple of years, you know, I think I got out of like a three to four year relationship. And you know, that was a relationship that I was holding on to because, you know, I was afraid to be alone because I felt like I needed something else to validate me and make me feel better about myself. I was doing a lot of things, you know, out of fear and, you know, really just trying to appeal to people at work more, you know, so I could capitalize on that, make more money. And, you know, really just looking for people to validate me, to tell me, you know, you're good, we like you, and things like that. And I wanted that so bad because I couldn't give that to myself, you know, because I, you know, I like everyone else struggle with, you know, self-esteem issues and insecurities and stuff like that. So, you know, these last couple of years have really been just a journey for me, you know, on the road of self-acceptance, and self-love, and just learning to accept myself for who I am. And, you know, looking at all those things that I may have looked at in the past as defects or, you know, flaws, and, just really taking a neutral to positive stance on them and realizing that those are the things that make me up, you know? And, you know, if I'm doing good things with my life, and, you know, I'm living an honest life and I'm trying to do what's right, then I'm happy that those things make me up because, you know, I'm doing a good thing. So yeah, I think that would be the theme. And, yeah, really just take a look at, my journey into being comfortable with myself, being comfortable being alone, and, you know, just really just being grateful for the people that I do have, versus the people that I don't.
Thank you, Matt. That was a great response. And I just want to thank you for being here today and allowing me to interview you and speak more about your own experiences, your own obstacles, and how you were able to overcome them and share some positive light throughout your own life and, you know, others that you're impacting today. So, you know, it was truly a pleasure to have you on, and it's, you know, I really look forward to continuing our relationship. It's such an honor to be your friend, and, you know, luckily we were able to get through a lot of these obstacles that were big hurdles within our life, especially at such a young age. And, you know, it's commendable that you're here today and we're able to have this conversation. So I'm so thankful for that. And with that being said, I want to thank you all for listening to the 11th episode of the Mental Insights Podcast with my good friend, Matthew Wray. And we'll have links to Matt's social media if you want to reach out and chat with him, see a little bit more of what he was able to do within his own life, and if you just want to follow to see what he's doing today and how he can maybe help you on your own road to recovery, whether it's, you know, any type of obstacle that you're facing. So thank you again, Matt. It was truly a pleasure.
Thank you, dude. I really appreciate it.
Of course, dude. I'm glad we were able to do that. I'm glad we were able to make it happen.
Me too, brother.
Yeah, that was great. That was great. I think it went well. So I think the day that I will post it is, so it'll be May 29th. So I'm scheduling them out Mondays and Wednesdays every week now. So Yeah, so you're third up. So you're the 11th episode, because I'm posting 9 on this Wednesday, 10 next Monday, and then next Wednesday. So I'll have enough time to edit it and such. And yeah, I'll post it all online, and we'll get it out there for everybody to hear.
Sick, dude. Yeah, thanks for having me.